Tell me just an overview of the first one.
Love and Bones.
Love and Bones.
That is not me going up the stairs. People ask me that all the time.
Okay.
It started with a few poems that I had written for my master's thesis about my family and the Holocaust.
Okay.
Which then went out to... my master's thesis was centered around that. And I had had a publisher who had heard me read about 3 years prior to that... asked me to send him some work, and I just was really busy and I never got around to it. And then I had a major concussion and I wasn't able to write. I was able to edit at one point but not write, and I was feeling like I needed to do something to find that writer in myself again. So I approached him and said, are you still interested in my work? He said, sure, send me something. So I did, and he said, yeah, let's publish it. And this came out of that. So it's a combination of writing from that time in my life and earlier, and then having had the concussion and doing the edits and allowing me to come back into my writing life in that way. So.
Yeah, it's a great book. I enjoy it a lot. It's a very personal book. It's about your experiences, quite a bit of it anyway. It's about your family,
mm-hmm.
Your parents, children, marriage.
I don't always draw from personal experience, but a lot of what I do draw from is personal. It's my story, and hopefully it gives people something to relate to that they can find in their own lives and take away and say, oh, okay, I can relate to that and I understand where she's coming from, and maybe that'll help somebody mm-hmm. in something they're going through, just to understand something a little more, or just to know they're not alone and somebody else has gone through that same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because I think fundamentally, you know, our stories might be different, but there's something that we can relate to at some point. You know, there's a cross section for sure.
Mm-hmm.
And if someone's going through something similar, in sharing our stories, I really believe it helps everybody to heal. So.
Mm-hmm. So do you consider yourself more of a therapist or an artist?
Depends on the day.
Does it? Yeah.
Depends where I am.
It's an interesting line with you, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because of your background, your education, and your art training and your writing.
Yeah.
How do you decide which hat you're putting on at that moment?
It really depends on the audience. But I think because of who I am and my experience, I bring it all with me. I can't help it.
Right.
So I work with children with disabilities, and often I know, even though I'm not, part of the job isn't the therapeutic part, I bring that with me, and I think it helps me to understand these kids a lot better.
Mm-hmm.
So when I'm doing a workshop that's a writing workshop, I can't help bring the expressive arts into that. So there's all these cross sections. And then when I'm working with a client one-on-one, the arts certainly are a huge part of that, and because I'm a writer, I can't help but look for metaphor in people's lives.
Mm-hmm.
So,
what kind of possibilities do you see for yourself at strictly as a writer? Where would you like to see your career going?
I'm taking what I'm learning and applying it to what I see people's challenges are in communicating, whether it is through language differences or cultural differences or economic differences or gender differences, and how to bridge that gap and get a conversation going.
Mm-hmm.
That's where my interests lie.
Okay.
Yeah, and for me it's doing it using poetics as a way of bridging that gap somehow.
there are three poems in Love and Bones that I really love and resonate with me. And one of them is of Love and Bones. Mm. And in it, you describe yourself as a young girl lying on the kitchen floor listening to your mother and I'm assuming aunts and maybe cousins mm-hmm. cooking Passover.
Yeah.
And you're just a young girl. How old did you envision yourself when you did that?
Yeah, probably around six, seven.
Six. Right.
Tops, yeah.
So you're lying there as a child, you're listening.
Yeah.
And you're dozing, according to this poem, you're dozing every now and then. What a beautiful, warm, safe place for a child to be. Mm. What does one learn from an experience like that? When you're just sitting there and you're not even looking at the people, you're just envisioning what they look like, but you're listening to them. You're underneath the kitchen table with your feet up on a chair leg somewhere. Tell me about that. When you wrote about that in this, I went straight to that world. I didn't do that. I did that with my father in his tool shop. Mm-hmm. I would just hang out in there. And I was way too young to touch anything, but I just loved the smell of wood and metal and what he did. And what kind of experiences did you have with your family when you were growing up like that?
Well, I think, and we were discussing this before, that sometimes it takes 30 years for you to realize the impact of it, because as a child, you're just immersed in it. You're just there, and you don't know that this is going to be significant later. And I think it's something you take away, and those are the moments that you try to keep recreating in your own life. You know, if you have children, you try and create those kinds of moments, whether it's subconscious or consciously, where you can just be and just be comfortable with everything going on around you. And for me, looking back and being able to do that, because I grew up in a household with 11 people, it was a little chaotic, it was extended European household, so to have those moments where you could just be in it and appreciate it and just feel safe were pretty special.
Mm-hmm. And could you still smell that kitchen?
Oh yeah.
What's
yeah, and I can
like?
Still hear them yelling back and forth at each other. Stir the pot. No, yeah, you stir the pot.
More salt.
Yeah, yeah.
That
was exactly
pot.
How it was. So,
Yeah. I did hang out in my mom's kitchen too, because that's where it was just warm. It was friendly and safe and fun.
Yeah.
I do remember that too. But when you wrote about that in this poem, Love and Bones, it completely resonated with me, and I'm mm-hmm. sure it will with most people. What I find interesting about this poem, though, and about you in particular, is how easily you move between conscious and subconscious thought, and you can segue between happy thought and nightmarish thoughts. And in this poem in particular, in the beginning of the first half of it, we're talking about a nice, warm, fragrant kitchen with people having fun and working together, maybe arguing in a family way. And the second half of the poem nicely segues into a reflection of your mother's horror and nightmare.
I mean, the poems go through lots of rewrites. So, and that poem started off in some ways as a different poem and then moved its way into this collection I was working on. So, it was written about the Holocaust in my family. So that is intentional. But I think it also is knowing that that is always there with you. You carry that in your bones. I was just talking to somebody yesterday about the research that they are now finding that there's something psychologically, or actually that happens to your brain when you are a child of a survivor, that is transferred. And so the brain patterns change from someone who isn't. And then, of course, that, as you go along from generation to generation, becomes less. But I think that it's really important to show how you can have the everyday and be in the everyday and moments like that. And in the background, there is this horror, especially for, I mean, for me, I was removed from it because it wasn't a part of my history. I wasn't there. But for people who are involved in war, who you try and, you know, I would imagine trying to find those moments where you don't have the horror that you're living with every day. And remembering those times can be quite hard. But I think for all of us in all of our lives, we have that back and forth. I don't think it's just me. I think we all do. The simple and the complex. Where does it come from? It just, you know, it just comes out when I write. And then when I edit, some things just make sense and some things don't. Some things have to come out and some things I'll keep. Yeah. Or I could take a line from a poem and start something entirely different.
How much of a difference does it make for you as a writer having your psychological training and your human behavior?
I think it makes a huge difference. I think it has changed the way I write in that I think the one thing that's really hard as a writer when you're writing from a personal place is so you're not whining or you're not complaining or you're not because that's not what it's about. It's about finding a place that everyone can relate to, but telling your story at the same time, that's important.
Yeah.
And so I think in the training it's helped me to realize more what is important and what parts. It's okay, I don't have to tell everything and share everything. I can keep some things to myself.
Right.
And I think it's helped with my editing, for sure. And also, it's helped me see my own themes. And I think to take it in a different direction. And sometimes if I feel stuck, just to be able to write and let go, and then to know where I want to go.
Yeah.
And what's therapeutic and what is poetic.
Interesting. What's therapeutic? When you first started writing, was writing a cathartic process for you?
I started at 13, and okay. I started writing poetry and short stories. And it was definitely creative and therapeutic at the same time.
Okay.
Yeah, definitely.
You have very strong relationships with both of your parents,
yes.
With your mother and your father, but they're different relationships.
Yeah.
There's some conflict there between the two of them. You write, quite often about the challenges that you had with your mother. Your mother was hypercritical,
mm-hmm.
made it hard for you growing up. You impacted your self-worth, you maybe questioned yourself for a long time and had to grow through that.
Mm-hmm.
And your father, on the other hand, was your mentor. He was someone that who was warm and patient with you, encouraging. He was a writer, correct? He was a writer.
He was a writer.
Was he a poet?
He wrote poetry. He read me poetry all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's nice. So you have that warm, loving relationship there and a little more harsh with your mom, constantly being pulled back and forth like many children.
Yeah.
Right? It happens quite often where we can't have a perfect lifestyle. How do you think that's impacted your writing, that dynamic between two opposing parents?
Well, it's interesting, as you were talking, I was thinking back to my master's thesis, and because it was primarily focused on that relationship, having been a survivor, my family and the Holocaust, and then being a survivor of someone like my mother who was very difficult to live with. And it was through that writing of that paper that I realized two things that I had never realized before. One was that my mother probably suffered from a mental illness, and which shifted the way I looked at her. And I had never viewed it that way before. And the other was that I had always felt totally alone, and I realized in writing that, even though I knew my father loved me, not only was he there, but I had all these other people on the outskirts in the family who couldn't say anything, but were really rooting for me, mm-hmm. and could see what was going on. It was beyond their capacity to step in and do anything, because mm-hmm. she was really quite brutal at times. She had a hard time growing up in a really hard, big family, and they didn't have a lot of money, and she was one of the younger ones, and probably wasn't noticed that much. And also, I think she had mental health issues right from the very start. And she was always telling us how my great-grandparents had died, and they were asphyxiated in their home before the Second World War. Mm. And she was always telling us how lucky they were, because they got to die together instead of in the death camps. And then I realized later that they had other relatives there who weren't that lucky, who ended up in the death camps. Mm-hmm. And I think that really stuck for her.
One of the other poems of Love and Bones that I really liked is When Dreams End. You almost taunt the reader by crossing so easily back and forth between a psychological barrier that even if they knew existed, they would struggle to reach it. Your words don't carry the weight of traditional rules of our waking world, but you write as if they do. And this mixing of both worlds, is this subconscious act conscious?
I don't think so.
Are you aware and steering it, or does it just flow and you catch it?
It just flows, definitely. It just flows and I catch it. Yeah. And I think that has to do with just living it. Living, as Carl Lego says, living poetically. And I think that is how I try to live my life and be in the poetics of it. And so when I write, it just flows. And hopefully that just flows into other parts of my life as well.
And how does it flow? Is it, do you write quickly? Do you write core ideas quickly?
It depends. Sometimes I do, sometimes lately I've been struggling a little more, and things have been harder coming, and having to do a lot more editing, a lot more being in it.
Is that because you're smarter? You're learning all this stuff now and you're harder?
It's definitely because I'm smarter.
Why do you think it has changed? It could be that. Sometimes just having a larger volume of knowledge makes it harder for us to make choices.
I think what happened, and this goes to the other book with the concussion, is going back into school and reactivating my brain in that kind of intensity made it harder for me to access my creative side, just because my brain was so full and tired and trying to work it.
When did your Ashley Judd come out?
Oh, that's an old poem, actually. That's a really old poem.
I like that poem a lot.
I wrote that in about 2002, just after I moved to Vancouver.
Did you?
Yeah. So it had nothing to do with the book. I just liked the poem. And for a while, it was a signature poem. I would read it at the end of every reading I would do. So, yeah.
Yeah, it says a lot. There's a strong message in that. And how did you work through that?
Through the poem or through the emotions?
Well, through the poem and through the emotion, yeah. How did that poem evolve?
I think it was, in context, the poem is about my relationship with my mother and how mm-hmm. she really wanted a daughter who was something other than I was.
Yeah.
And coming to terms with that myself. And knowing that inside there was someone beautiful waiting to come out, despite her telling me that wasn't the case. Mm-hmm. And I've read that to audiences where there are a lot of teenagers involved, because I think it's a really strong message for them and an important one to hear, that we're all beautiful. It's just we have to find that in ourselves. And
yeah.
So it was a lot of years of therapy.
Yeah. Okay. Honestly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And writing through it. And
introspection.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
That's a beautiful poem.
Thank you.
I think your best poems are about your father. Mm-hmm. Whenever you write about mm-hmm. your father, I lose it. I just become mm-hmm. jello. And maybe it's because I didn't have such a great relationship with my father. It's all right now, but it was a little tough for quite a few years, decades. And you had such a wonderful, warm relationship. And whenever you write about him, it just takes on a whole new life of itself. I was wondering if I give you your book, is there anything in here that you could read to us about your father that jumps out?
11 p.m. At the other end of the phone, my father, shaky voice trying to stay hopeful, blue water still fresh in his mind, names fade daily. When can we go fishing? Tomorrow. We become stuck in a parking lot of conversation, backing into the same spot over and over. He's desperate to go home, can smell lilacs blooming in the yard, envisions the plum tree burdened with fruit while snow falls past my window. These faded postcards stir a past I'm too busy to remember. He's too busy remembering to know to be afraid. At the other end of the phone, my father combats fear with questions, while the news cries in the background, "It's time for bed." I hear him nod, click, silence. I whisper, "I love you," into the evening air.
Each time we look at anything, and it doesn't matter whether it's words, whether we're reading words or we're looking at images, we see or experience it differently than we did the last time we saw it. Every time we read a book or read a passage, we think we're reading the same thing, but we're not. The subtlety is important. It takes us deeper into understanding or into a different area. So every time we read one of your poems, the neural pathways that we created for it get deeper and farther, and the little tributaries get more hair-like, and they spread out, so we have different understanding. Now this physiological process, it makes it impossible for the average person to see a work of art the same way each time. Even if we wanted to, we couldn't. Every time I read your work, I get something new out of it every single time. And I think it's because of this. I think because I just go a little bit deeper each time. Mm-hmm. And it stuns me sometimes when I'm reading your work. And I'll read it for the fifth time, and I didn't even notice what you were saying. And then I get it, and then that poem becomes all about that. But sometimes there is an epiphany. And it surprises me. Why do you think that happens with people? What is it, purely a physiological reason, or is there something that we can't put our finger on? Is there a metaphysical thing? Is it a combination? What do you attribute that growth to of liking something when maybe you didn't like it at first, or you didn't understand it? What happens with you when you read your work over and over again, or when you read somebody else's work, or look at a painting? How do you approach that?
I think it's a combination of the two. I think you can't separate them. I think it goes hand in hand. I think it also, because there are times when I read up my own work and I put it down and I think, oh, I don't want to read that again for a long time, I don't like it. And then other times I come back to it and it's like, oh, did I write that? Was that somebody else's? Good writing. You can read it over and over again, you come back to it, and it does do that. It doesn't matter how many times you read it, it moves you, it elicits something into you that you can't explain, and that you come away with something different all the time. And I think that is art in general.
Uh-huh.
And I think it also has to do with where we're at personally.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I have to admit, there are certain songs that I'm just never going to like, no matter how many times I hear it. It's like, it's going to get in. But it's true, I will end up humming them.
Yeah.
And,
yeah, we do. You know, we learned to manipulate that. We learned to use that to draw people in more and more. I was a young man when I first started thinking about that. I was in my early 20s. And for 20 years, I watched as we released songs. And I watched the impact from the live shows that we did, and we were doing arena style. We were doing 20,000 people a night, and I would talk to the fans afterwards and talk to them about the new songs, and they didn't like them, but they were growing on them. So I found that intriguing. And I also learned that people who had serious emotional challenges were more drawn to that. And I could tell those fans.
Okay.
We had 50 of those fans who traveled with us for decades, show to show to show. And they were lonely people. I never knew what their emotional challenges were, but you can just tell by looking at them and talking to them for five minutes. You know, they bring their dog and they're talking to you through their dog. They can't tell you their emotions directly, but their dog can. All kinds of stuff like that. But I ended up focusing on these people because it allowed me to see the rawness of the appreciation of art.
Yeah.
Because they couldn't hide their emotion.
And they probably wouldn't be able to tell you where it came from or why.
They had no idea.
They just knew it was there. It affected them and they wanted more of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it was probably in some way, a happy moment, in another way a release of something that they needed to let go of. And I think that's one of the things that we can do as artists, whether it's good or bad, hopefully it's good, but is to give that people that release, because they can connect and let out some of that emotion in their story, especially if they've been brutalized.
Yeah.
And they don't have a voice to do it themselves, if they don't have a way into it.
Yeah.
So,
that's why art is so important.
That is one of the reasons.
That's
absolutely.
Bridge, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's one of the reasons.
Yeah.
But that really is important. That serves a real need.
And it does. And it, I'm in a place now in the academic world where we're bringing art into academic writing. And so we have this whole debate about why and why is it important, how does it change it, and what significance. And so it's not just scientific research. You're bringing in this whole other means of doing and being, and it's opened up a lot of questions.
Yeah.
So, but it's also very important work.
Yeah.
Because they're finding that there's this whole other part of the world that needs to be examined in that way.
Yeah, so art does break down that barrier that we build around ourselves.
Absolutely.
Right? That's the barrier that we use as protection. And we don't know that we're protecting ourselves.
Yeah.
It punches holes through it so light can come through and ideas can come through.
Yeah, and one of the things that I'm proposing for my research for my PhD is to work with kids who have been marginalized for whatever purpose, as I said, and using art to build those bridges, to get conversations going, to give them ownership and to give them a place where they can go. There's this whole thing called the third space, where it's third space theory, where you create this other space other than your home and school or work, where you can go and, especially if you're on the margins, create a space where you can find your voice. And art, I think, creates that third space for people.
So taking that into consideration, and we touched on this lightly earlier, how does symbolism play a role?
Mm-hmm.
Because to me, symbols fill the holes that words leave behind.
Okay.
Words can't express all emotion and feeling. There are no words for some things we feel.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the whole. But do symbols and paintings and photographs, do they fill those holes or help us fill those holes? Help us look deeper into the subconscious?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. That's an interesting question because I just want to take it back a step to address two things. One is that when you look at writing, there are symbols and metaphor throughout writing that, but as you say, sometimes, and that's the challenge of good writing, is to be able to fill those holes and to find those symbols and that way into that in a different way. I think they all do the same thing. I think they all serve the same purpose, to take us to that other place. And I think that other is what's really important. And I think the symbols and the metaphor make us look at life differently and give us that aha moment, or that moment of, oh dear, but an understanding of it in a different way that makes us all human in one sense and also understand the challenges on the other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you want to look purely at language development, I mean, symbol, that's all what it is symbols. The symbols that we give to the things around us. That's what language is. And then you take it into other art forms, and it's just transposing it into a different art form.
Mm-hmm. Photographers and painters, mm-hmm, use symbolism. It could be allegorical.
Yeah.
It could be spiritual. There's a lot of different tools we use. And I'm also a writer, so I use symbolism a little differently in my writing.
Mm-hmm.
And and psychologists and human behaviorists, they use symbolism too. And all of our symbols in all of these different disciplines aren't exactly the same.
Yeah.
But there is some point where they overlap. And I think finding that overlap is where we reconnect with people,
mm-hmm,
outside of ourselves, because you'll create symbols as a writer, and the reader may not understand symbolism that writers use, but they do understand their religious symbolism.
Yeah,
they understand that. Do you ever consciously try and meld that symbolism? In other words, do you write for what you think the reader will understand? Does that happen at that level?
Yeah, I think so. There are times, again, I'm drawing from metaphor because I use metaphor, and as I just think in metaphor when I write. That's just how I do it, and in symbols. And if I'm writing something with a specific purpose, I make sure my metaphor are all lined up, and or the symbolism is consistent. I don't want to be drawing someone all over. So it's a conscious thing.
Mm-hmm.
But I have a question for you.
Sure.
Because I'm looking at this incredible photograph that you took behind you, of all these heads, and I'm wondering about your intent, because do you realize that, I mean, it looks like a T, but it also looks like a cross?
Mm-hmm. It is a cross.
Okay.
I'm Catholic.
Okay, so...
The title of that is Rumors. I'm not religious. I'm spiritual, metaphysical.
Okay.
I love voodoo, and I love what draws people into symbols. That's,
yeah,
you're right, that's symbolic.
Yes.
All of my... Everything I do is symbolic,
yeah,
in that way.
And I think, for me, it is as well, just in a different way.
Yeah.
And I think our symbols are really important to us, because I think it takes us to that deeper spiritual place, that place where we can't always explain. And it gives it power and meaning and something concrete to hold on to. If you ever read any Carl Jung, he was very poetic in his writing, but he uses a lot of symbolism,
yeah,
throughout it. And talking about the psyche, and religion and all of those things that sometimes are a little beyond our grasp, I think the symbols give us a place to all go to,
mm-hmm,
where we can understand it. Something that isn't as concrete, it gives it something a little more concrete that we can catch. This is a poem I wrote in response to another poet, Naomi Shaib Nye, who is a Lebanese-American and writes a lot about her experience as a Lebanese-American and the people that she knows and loves. So
Okay. This
is my response to her. A Jew sits at a computer screen wearing a hat, listening to rain. An Arab poet she has never met recites poetry, her stories, the missing of the homeland, held on the page for her aching Lebanese father, who plants fig trees in a Texas yard. We both wear masks to hide the horror of displacement, the dust of our narrations circling through our blood. She is caught between worlds, and I am a Jew who doesn't know the complexity of the history that has landed us here. My father, like hers, was hated not for the color of his skin, but his name. Like hers, his faith. My father, like hers, planted his love, sprouting words and children. He listened to the storms that approached with fear. Fathers on the other side of the world sing for their children as the poet and I sing for our fathers. Not all men carry guns, bring terror. It is only the mad warrior who carries the bomb. A poet's heart can change his identity, give him a flower bed to lie in with his lover. The poet has signed off. I hold her worry and love. Tonight, a Palestinian and a Jew held conference. It is only a matter of time before we begin to believe what is written, what is said, what is heard.